anyway, my Gibson J45, as promised. As I say, I was trying to figure out when I actually bought this, because I assumed I bought it somewhere around 1975. But looking at the dates of when I moved to Kingston, Surbiton, it might have been as late as 1979, which seems a bit strange to me, because I went to university, I went to Kingston Poly in 81. So I thought I was living in the Avenue for longer than that. But anyway, I bought this somewhere in the 70s, so I've had this, you know, like a good 40 years plus. And as I say, it started out originally as a Cherry Sunburst. And somewhere in the 80s, the scratch plate came off. It used to have a J45 back wing scratch plate, which came off. And you can just about possibly make out underneath the back wing, or where the back wing was, a little bit of cherry that's left. But you can see it's actually faded to this really toasty golden brown, which I think is actually a lot nicer than a lot of J50s that I've seen. And like I say, the guy I bought it from, when I bought it from him, he was in the process of changing the tuners. These are shallow by the look of it. And I'll get around to talking about the repairs that I had done on this later on. So he changed the tuners out, but he changed out the adjustable bridge. This has got a fixed bridge. And like I say, it's not the original. It's not a correct bridge anyway. It's like, I think he handmade it rather than it being a Gibson bridge, because it should be adjustable, like the Epiphone Texans bridge, but the just the other way up. This is turning out to be a bit like the story with the Maton that I've got, because like I say, I did lots of comparison videos. If you go back to the like 2013, 2014, 2015, because I was beginning to think that maybe this guitar is not as good as I thought it was. I mean, it's always been the yardstick by which you measure other guitars. The Gibson J45 has always been like everybody who's anybody who's got one, James Taylor, Ralph McTell, John Renborn, Donovan, you know, anybody who's anybody had a J45. So you assume that they must be good. But as I say, I was beginning to think, I mean, part of the problem is my nails. As I said before, my nails grow really quickly and they are like iron, you know, like they are so tough. And I think, I mean, most guitarists, if you listen to them, have a style that's not necessarily distinct, but usually their own. Like James Taylor, you can tell James Taylor playing guitar just like that. Same with people like Ralph McTell and John Renborn. They've all got a subtle sound that is their own. And I think what happens with me is with my nails, it doesn't matter what guitar I'm playing. the nails actually dominate the sound that I'm making. So all of my guitars sound exactly the same when I play them, because my nails. Having said that, like I say, as with the Maton, I put on new strings and I played it for a little bit and, you know, stuck it back in the case and played other guitars for a while. And this is one of those guitars, because the neck is narrow, if you look at the nut there, that is exactly 4 centimetres across. And the Epiphone is exactly 4 centimetres across as well. So both guitars I find incredibly difficult to play these days. And just a word about that. As I say, I got Feline guitars in South Croydon to refret, straighten out the neck and refret my Epiphone Texan. And you might be able to see if I catch the light. Maybe, maybe not. There's still some pitting on the neck of my J45, but I got them to put exactly the same frets to shave the neck slightly. put on exactly the same frets as on the Epiphone Texan. And this is, I was going through a period where it wouldn't stay in tune, and even if I got it in tune, because of the pitting, I would bend the strings and the strings would sound as if they're out of tune anyway. But all that is fixed now. It's got exactly the same frets. It's got exactly the same neck, apart from the scale length. So both guitars feel almost identical. The back of the neck on this one, one of the problems that Gibson had is imperfections would get into their lacquering. And over the years, those imperfections would start to bubble. And the neck, unfortunately, on this guitar, is just covered in little bubbles from imperfections in the lacquer. Where was I? The cherry's faded, the bridge has been replaced, and I was saying the strings, I put new strings on it and it didn't sound all that good, and I put it back in the case and played other guitars for a little while, and I dragged it out of the case a few days ago to in preparation for making this video. And it sounds tremendous. It sounds much better than it's ever sounded before. And better than my Martin, I think. So there's just no accounting for the way guitars behave. You know, maybe it's humidity, maybe it's the something in the chemicals in the interior of the case, but for some reason the old J45's decided to perk up a little bit. The cherry sunburst is faded slightly, and you might be able to again see what I was talking about with the checking or the sort of crackling that's gone on with the lacquer over the years, and there's quite a lot of cracking going on with this baby. But the back, I don't know if you can remember the I'll show the Epiphone in a second. This is what it should look like, reasonably shiny. I mean, this has been knocked about over the years, but it's still reasonably shiny. Whereas the finish on the Texan, like I say, it has this like graining, as if it's not been properly filled before it was varnished, and it looks completely different to the sides, but there you go. One of the other problems I had with this was because the tuners aren't the original tuners, and they've been replaced, and then over the years they've worked loose, and some of the screws have actually broken off. And there are holes where the original tuners went on, and I got Feline to sort that all out for me as well, because there was another problem with tuning. It just wouldn't tune properly because the tuners were loose. And you tighten the string and the tuners like twist around. I've had this guitar for a very long time, and I've thought about selling it before, but I'd be stupid to. It's a really, really good guitar. The only other thing I'd say about this was the other thing Feline did was to cleat this crack. There is a crack in the front, and all I can say about that is it's grown like 2 inches in 40 years. The crack was there when I got it, and it has got bigger, but it's got bigger at a very slow rate. So I'm really pleased with this guitar, and I'd like to put an adjustable bridge back on it if I could, but it's just sounding so good at the moment, you know, like it's not broke, so don't fix it. And the other thing I wanted to talk about was strings, because I was going to talk about guitar mythology, and there's lots of mythology about strings, and plenty of mythology about materials and how you build things, and even frets and tuners, to be honest. But the one thing that I did to this a couple of years ago was I replaced it, had a plastic bridge, a bridge saddle, And I replaced that with Tusk, and I replaced the bridge pins with Tusk, and I think I asked Feline to replace the nut with Tusk as well while they were at it. And it did make a slight but noticeable improvement to the the volume went up by, say, I don't know, 5 or 10%, not a lot, but enough to be noticeable. And it did sound slightly better, you know, like, if however you qualify, slightly better sounding guitars. It's a very difficult thing to do with guitars, I know, but to my untrained ears, it sounded slightly better. So I think my preferred, because I think the Martin's got a Tusk bridge saddle to it. The Epiphone, obviously, the adjustable bridges on Epiphones and Gibsons, some were ceramic and some are made of rosewood and some might even be made of ebony. So there's probably a lot of mythology going around about, even within adjustable bridges, what materials you should use and which would be best. But the rule of thumb, and I say this all the time, is go visit music shops, pick up as many guitars as you can and play them. Because sooner or later, one will stand out. And that's the one that you buy and stick with. Because even now, I remember in the early days of playing guitar, going to a music shop in Southampton in my hometown, and I picked up an Epiphone, and it had exactly the right width, exactly the right curve radius, exactly the right profile radius. It felt just really, really good. And I still to this day remember picking that guitar up and thinking, oh, this is a really, you know, this is better than my J45 that I had. So with all things, like with me, like I said, when I got divorced and I started buying guitars, the idea was I'd buy them on eBay, and if I like them, I keep them. And if I don't like them, I sell them on. So I got through about 50 or 60 guitars since 2013 that way. And I'm quite happy to buy a pup. And I will, you know, sell it on as a pup as well. But in the process of doing that, like I say, I've ended up with the Maton, the Larrabee, the Texan, the J35. They're all really good guitars, and I doubt if I'll part with any of those, unless really big numbers are thrown at me. But I've been quite happy to pass on ones that I wasn't quite so happy with as well. So eBay is one way of doing it. If you're aware of the fact that you might be buying something that's utter rubbish, or, you know, is just really horrible, then if you're happy to sell it on, then that's fine. But the best, you know, obviously the best way to find the guitar of your dreams is to go and play them as many as you can, and one will jump out at you one day, regardless of make, model, year, or you know, aesthetic looks. And the same with strings. I started off, when I first started playing, I was using Rotosound. And I used to use electric strings because I wanted the lightest gauge possible to, you know, to make it as easy as possible to play the guitar. And Rotosound were pretty good. And then I experimented with Ernie Ball and Gibson. And then I finally settled on Daddario. And I used Daddario up until the 2000s, almost exclusively, Daddario Phosphor Bronze. I swore by them. They give a really good sound. They're really consistent. They last a long time. I've got no complaints about them. But when I got the Martin, I tried a set of Martin strings. And like I say, to my astonishment, when you put new strings on the Martin, it sounds phenomenal. It just sounds unbelievably good. The bass really growls. I mean, it's got a grrr to it that's... you know, you can feel through your body. And the trebles are like a Martin should sound. They sound like bells. They really ring, and you can hear your nail against the string. And the odd thing, I'm sure it's psychological, but what I found odd was they felt really smooth, whereas the Daddario strings had a kind of roughness to them that I'm sure is imaginary, but it's almost as if Martin polished their strings and Daddario don't. You know, like I could imagine in a factory somewhere, you know, like miles and miles of steel cable being stretched out. And then, you know, there's a branching off where one set goes directly to Daddario and the other set goes through a polishing machine and goes off to Martin. And so I started using Martin almost exclusively for a couple of years. But friends of mine use Elixir, and everybody raves on about how great Elixir are. So I bought some Elixir strings, and I've got Elixirs on here at the moment, and there are Elixirs on that maton. And they're fantastic, they're a really good string. Like I say, with the Larrivé, when I put them on the Larrivé, my fingers were sliding about all over the place because they're smooth. I can't remember if it's the Nano Web or the other one that they do, but one of them, the winding on most strings is still a circular wire going around the interior part of the string. But with Elixir, the circular wire is then flattened, so you don't get squeaking on the strings. And one of the interesting things I discovered when I first used Elixirs is it's my fingers that squeak, it's not the strings, because my fingers still squeak on an Elixir Nano Web strings. So yeah, Elixirs are pretty good, but I've gone back to Daddario, and you know, I've got no complaints really. They're equally good string. And lately I tried this these strings I'd never heard before, Olympia. I put them on one of the guitars I've got, I forget which one. Brilliant. You know, they're I've never heard of them before. You might be interested in Sean David's channel. He has done, for electric guitars, he's done a strings comparison test where he's tried about 10 or 12 different brands of string. And he came up with, for electric guitar, Rotosound as being the best. I bought some Rotosound strings. Just like I said, I used them when I first started playing. I bought some Rotosound strings to try as soon as I've, you know, like, I'll probably put them on the Martin because the Martin's strings are dead. But yeah, Paul David's. I'll put a link in the description. And also Rick Beato and Rhett Shull did a gauge test on acoustic guitars. And to my surprise, it seemed that the weight of the gauge didn't make a marked impression on tone, because I'd always been under the impression, I always used the lightest gauge possible in the early days, but just a few years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, I started playing, my usual string was like 10 to 48, and then I started playing 12 to 52. And I found that after the pain threshold had been passed, you know, that wall had been passed through, it actually helps, because the tension of the string gives you more, to my mind, a more positive feel to playing. And I was under the impression that it would improve tone, because obviously the lighter the gauge, the more jangly it would, you know, eventually, apparently you can get 0.6 on electric guitar. Some people play like a 0.6 to a 10. But obviously that's going to be quite jangly, and especially on an acoustic guitar, it's just going to rattle all the time. So the heavier gauge is what you would, you'd normally be expected to go for. Yes, well, that's about it. I mean, I could suppose I could briefly mention different tunings. Over the years, I've learned a few songs that have different tunings. For instance, Vestapol, which is DADGBE, no, DADA, well, whatever they are. So you can experiment with different tunings. That's always a good idea because then you can just fret one. No, or one fret at a time. Yeah, I don't know what else to say about the J45 really, except it's sounding exceptionally good at the moment. I was thinking of selling it, but I'd be stupid to. And it's a good twin brother to the Texan. Again, it's got this what I call striation, but it's called torrefication. Which it looks like it might be showing up on the camera, which is the grain is vertical, obviously, but you can see there are this torrefication. It's like oh, I don't know what you call it, like snake scales or something. And the more of it shows up in the wood, then usually the better quality piece of wood that you've got. And it's quite noticeable on here. And maybe you can see here what I was referring to as bear claw, which is another good sign in the guitar. And this has just got the one. And the weird thing is that the wood is usually book matched. You take one piece of wood and you split it and then glue it down the middle so that it's a reflection. But bear claws, you'll only get on one side. So although this is book matched, the bear claw will only appear on one side. And this has only got the one, so. And the only other thing to say is, like I say, the back wing scratch plate was hanging off when I first got it, and it came off somewhere in the 80s. And I've made a horrible job of patching things up. But it doesn't really need it. I mean, all the marks on here now, you can ding this as much as you want, and it makes no difference because it's so dinged up anyway. Which is a good thing because although it's a, it's a precious antique, you don't have to be precious with it. It can take any bit of knocking about that you care to throw it. So, yeah, unless I think of anything else, that about wraps it up for my current lineup of guitars. Maybe see you again. Bye bye. I'm currently breeding J45s, so if you want one, you have to wait a few years till it grows up.